Thank you, everybody, for joining. It's my great pleasure to welcome Effie Apostolou here today. I've been a long-term fan of Effie's work. Effie studied biology at the Aristotle University in Greece, and where she's published a seminal paper in Cell by the time, and then in 2009 joined Konrad Hochedlinger's lab, where she's worked on, you know, in the prime time of stem cells and iPSCs, and has done some amazing work there. And now since 2014, she's an associate professor of molecular biology at Weill Cornell Medicine, and has received several awards, including Jane Coffin's Child Foundation and EMBO Postdoctoral Fellowship, and the NIH Director's New and Innovator Award, and the Emerging Leader Award from the Mark Foundation. And if you would talk about the interplay between 3D chromatin organization and transcription during self-made decisions. And thanks a lot for presenting your work today. I'm really looking forward to it.
Thank you so much, Stefan. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really glad to finally meet you, because I also follow your work for quite a while. And to be here, even virtually, I'm really looking forward for more discussions like the one we had this morning. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming to the talk. Today, I'm going to present a couple of different directions that my lab is interested in, and particularly on the molecular mechanisms that determine self-fate decisions. So we all know that cell identity needs to be very tightly regulated in order to have a proper embryonic development and tissue homeostasis. And every time that a cell divides, it needs to decide whether it will maintain its identity or will give rise to a new differentiated cell or progenitor. And if things go wrong during these decisions, you may get pathogenic situations ranging from lineage infidelity all the way to transformation. But if we learn how these decisions are made, we may be able to push rationally cell identity towards directions that are of therapeutic relevance with a process such as reprogramming or directed differentiation. So I, of course, understanding how cell identity is regulated is not a trivial task. And this is a simplistic slide of the layers of regulatory layers that we are mostly interested in. So first, we appreciate, obviously, that cells communicate with the environment where they accept several signals. And these will turn on transcription factors, which together with cofactors that will bind to enhancers or promoters of the target genes in order to activate them or repress them. Now, the binding of these factors, as well as the transcriptional outcome, also depends in several epigenetic layers, such as the presence or absence of DNA methylation, a presence of activating or repressive histone marks or variants, and finally, in a 3D chromatin topology or organization, which is one of the main interests in the lab. And all of this together will specify the cell type specific program. So I guess needless to say in this crowd, but when we talk about 3D chromatin organization, we talk of this hierarchical folding of the genome, initially obviously around nucleosomes, but then these chromatin fibers will form this long-range interactions, which are very important because they may bring distal regulatory elements such as enhancers to the target genes. And many of these interactions, they will be usually organized in highly interacting self-organized domains that are usually called topologically associated domains. And they are often demarcated by insulating boundaries that may prevent or eliminate some of the interactions between, let's say, enhancers in the one domain with genes in the other domain. In a more larger scale, many of these topological associated domains are also organized in larger structures that they are called compartments. And there are two types of compartments that they are largely correspond to what we call euchromatin or heterochromatin. So we have A compartments that contain their gene rich, active, and very accessible. And these, they tend to organize together and segregate away from the B compartments that they are much more heterochromatin, gene poor and inactive. So over the last two, maybe now three decades, people start appreciating that 3D chromatin organization is important for a number of biological processes, including recombination, translocation, gene expression, and also that features of this 3D chromatin organization are cell type characteristic. The reason that we are particularly interested in 3D organization is that we appreciate that if we move away from this linear view of the genome where enhancers and genes are intermixed in very complex ways and appreciate the way they are organized in the three-dimensional space with all of these hierarchical layers, we may be able to better understand how enhancer activity and specificity, so when an enhancer controls a gene and not another neighboring gene, or gene co-regulation, when two genes may be regulated from the same enhancer, and also potential regulatory hierarchies or redundancies, which are very often among enhancers. So two of the main directions with a kind of an enhancer-centric approach, I would say we have two main directions in the lab, which will consider the two main parts of my talk today. One is we try to understand the interplay between 3D chromatin organization and transcription in the context of self-aid chains, such as reprogramming or linear specification. But also we are really interested about this interplay in the context of self-renewal. So when cells need to divide, undergo mitosis, and then to reset their identity in the daughter cells. And today we'll start with this second story first. It was a recent a publication driven by two very talented scientists in my lab, an MD PhD student, Bobby, and Alex Polizos, who is a computational instructor who performed actually most of the analysis that I will present today throughout my talk. So what we often forget and we don't consider often a problem is that every time that the cell divides, undergoes a temporal crisis of cell identity. And the reason for that is that during mitosis, there are multiple very drastic molecular changes, including a global transcriptional shutdown, also dissociation or even degradation of important transcription factors and cofactors, drastic changes in the patterns and quality of histone modifications, and also a collapse of these 3D chromatin organization layers, looping TADs or compartments in a state that is cell type invariant. So somehow, while the cells are exiting mitosis, from this M to G1 transition, the daughter cells need to be faithfully reset all of these cell type defining features. And if they fail to do so, then a new identity may arise. So this intriguing problem of epigenetic inheritance is one of our a very important problem, and we decided to study specifically in pluripotent stem cells, and which are constituted a very interesting model for that question, because they constantly balance their ability to self-renew in culture while maintaining their immature state and the ability to respond to signals so they can differentiate to many different cell types. Moreover, pluripotent stem cells compared to other somatic cells are characterized by a very rapid cell cycle and an unusually short G1 phase, which is actually the window that has been shown to be the most critical for the decision between self-renewal versus differentiation. So we use the relatively straightforward system where we synchronize mouse pluripotent stem cells in at high purity in prometaphase, and then we release them for defined time points to enrich for early G1 or late G1 populations. And finally, we use asynchronous cells, which are, in case of mouse pluripotent stem cells, are mostly S2 phase, as a later stage. And the main question in mind is try to understand how these molecular features, such as nascent transcription and 3D chromatin organization, are reset from mitosis all the way to later in the daughter cells. To see how these are associated with important features of pluripotent stem cell identity. So for capturing nascent transcription, we use a process that's called PROSIC instead of RNA-seq, because it allows us to capture the single nucleotide and genome-wide resolution nascent transcriptional activity rather than steady-state RNA. So using PROSIC, we're able to see, in accordance with what has been described in other cell types, that indeed transcription is like globally shut down during mitosis, with only very few genes expressed at very low levels. But globally, it's very rapidly reset or even spike at the early G1 phase before it plateaus. And interestingly, PROSIC allows also to capture transcriptional activity of intergenic elements, such as enhancers. And we see a slightly different pattern with a little slower activation and peak of enhancers compared to genes, which could argue for slightly different requirements or mechanisms for this resetting, which is something that we are interested in investigating in the future. Now, within this broad trends of reactivation, we are able to cluster and find distinct groups of genes and enhancers and cluster them based on the stage where they reach the maximum transcriptional activity. For example, we find genes that indeed they are fully reset or even spike at the early G1, others that they are reset in a more slower fashion, and also a group of genes and enhancers that seem to be activated only during G1 stage and then silenced again. Genealogy categorization showed that all of our favorite stem cell regulators, genes associated with stem cell maintenance or self-renewal, are exclusively enriched in this early re-established group, whereas metabolic genes signaling a cell cycle are reset in a more slower fashion. Finally, and in accordance with what people have described based on RNA-seq in the past in human and mouse pluripotent stem cells, it seems that these transiently reactivated genes are included many lineage regulators, which you normally don't expect to see expressed in regular asynchronous cultures under self-renewing conditions like ours, but it seems that they are transiently activated and they're repressed again, potentially playing a role in priming. That's an assumption, obviously, for the moment. So in parallel with transcription, we checked a 3D chromatin organization by applying in situ HiSeq. I will just briefly describe that here, but and I will use it later in the talk as well. So this is based on the classic 3C-based technologies where you start with cross-linking of the cells to maintain 3D chromatin organization, and then you can perform restriction, digestion, and intramolecular ligation. So you end up with all of these kind of hybrid molecules, which represent the physical proximity, pairwise physical proximity in the 3D nucleus. And you sequence this in a pertinent manner. And once you map all of these reads, and depending on the resolution you are checking, you are able actually to infer each one of these hierarchical levels that I described at the beginning. So you get this checkerboard pattern that represents compartments, or these square-like domains that represent tags with stronger or weaker boundaries, and also distinct loops, distinct conducts that represent long-range chromatin interactions. So by applying in situ HiSeq on the same time points that we did proSeq during mitotic exit, first of all, we see that all of these beautiful patterns that you would see by HiSeq in asynchronous cells, like the checkerboard pattern again, or these tads and stripes, will be almost fully eliminated during mitosis. And that is in agreement with many other studies in different cell types. So during mitosis, you acquire this cell type invariant state. However, quickly after mitosis, we saw that all of these structures are rapidly re-emerging and continue getting strength later on. So to see this in a more genome-wide and a quantitative manner, so what we practically saw is that compartments are either fully lost or significantly weakened during mitosis, but they are rapidly segregated into A and B upon early G1 and continue gain definition and segregation later during the cell cycle. On the other hand, the insulation of the boundaries between tags, it seemed to reach their maximum strength already by early G1. So it seems to be among the very first features that they are set. Now, when we check out the level of looping, that appeared to be reset in a more gradual and slow manner, with all of the loops getting the maximum strength only on the end, and only a fraction of them being detected as early G1. And if we perform association analysis in this more fast or slow loops, we find that the fast reformed conducts are strongly enriched in active regulatory features, mediator, polymerase, K27 acetylation, etc. So they may represent enhancer promoter active regulatory conducts, whereas the slow conducts are mostly enriched just in CTCF and cohesin and are devoid of the other activating features, representing potential structural loops. Obviously, we were interested to see if there is any degree of synchronization, of coordination between the transcription and architectural resetting. And we did see some of this, especially at the large scale level, since compartments, for example, that contain early activated genes and enhancers are the first one to reset their compartmentalization strength compared to the rest. And the same goes for insulation, where boundaries that contain early activated genes or elements reach a much stronger insulation by early G1. However, this correlation between transcription and 3D organization was a little more difficult to set on, at least by HiSeq, since every loop around early activated or late activated elements had almost identical degree of resetting. Maybe the only exception for the based on our HiSeq data is that super enhancers seem to engage faster to the reformation of loops compared to other enhancer elements or intergenic regions. So to summarize all of this, this type of analysis allows to generate a 4D molecular roadmap upon mitotic exit, where we observe distinct waves of transcriptional reactivation that seem to associate with specific properties of pluripotency. For example, stemness and self-renewal program is the first to be reset. And then also you have this trans activation of some lineage-specific regulators. Also, we saw that architectural resetting is happening also at distinct patterns, with tag boundaries being among the first to be reset, and enhancer promoter conduct, and specifically super enhancer conduct, being faster than structural loops. Overall, there is some degree of coordination also between the two processes, but as I mentioned, it was surprisingly little compared to the hypothesis that we had at the beginning. So something that also captured attention here is that all of these differential kinetics. So we are wondering what may determine this faster or slower resetting of these molecular features. And after we excluded many different possibilities, we decided to turn our attention to mitotic bookmarking. And this is a process that has been described in multiple cell types so far. It's in contrast with what I mentioned at the beginning, that during mitosis, you have this very massive depletion of marks and transcription factors from the mitotic and compacted chromatin, and obviously the transcription silencing. It has been shown that selective marks and transcription factors may remain bound at some parts of the genome, also transcription in very few parts of the genome, and this may act as a bookmarks to facilitate a much more rapid resetting and reactivation of genes that are important for cell identity. So in the past, we have checked this problem in the context of mouse pluripotent stem cells, and we found a particular mark, H3K27 acetylation, to be selectively maintained in some parts of the genome during mitosis, and obviously lost in a large fraction of it. So we wondered whether this partial retention of K27 associates with faster transcriptional and architectural resetting. And that was the case indeed, based on just association analysis. We see that these regions that retain it have a much faster transcriptional reactivation and also are around loops that are reformed much faster. So that could suggest that this retention of that mark may act as an actual functional bookmark that may facilitate faster reassembly of transcriptional complexes or architectural complexes that will allow faster resetting. But to test this experimentally, we decided to deplete this mark specifically during mitosis and then ask what's happening at the level of transcription and 3D organization. For that, we took advantage of a P300 inhibitor, which is the main acetyl transferase of this mark. And we treated cells that undergo mitotic arrest with this inhibitor, but then we removed the inhibitor and the cortisol, and we let the cells reset. And you can see indeed to this treatment is sufficient to deplete a very large fraction of globally of H3K27 acetylation in mitotic cells, but quickly resets by early G1. So whatever effects we see are due to the perturbation specifically during mitosis and not at later stages. And this treatment actually showed that indeed transcription is globally transcriptional reactivation is globally perturbed when we deplete this mark, and we have thousands of genes being downregulated, so not being able to reactivate it to the same degree. And obviously, a large fraction of them contains what we assume to be bookmark genes. However, exactly the same treatment that has seen exactly the same cells, so very little changes. So practically no significant changes on the level of conducts, but also on the level of compartments or tags. And this is just one example. So by wrapping this results up, what we practically see is that H3K27 acetylation, or more specifically P300 activity at least, it seems to be necessary for bookmarking and promoting the proper transcriptional resetting, but also maintenance of transcription, which is something I did not show you, in interface cells. But it appears to be dispensable for the resetting of architecture, the 3D chromatin architecture. So this actually suggests that there may be a partial uncoupling between transcription and 3D chromatin organization that are at least driven by potentially different mechanisms. And this is one of the main ongoing directions in the lab, is try to dissect this mechanism and the degree of functional interplay between 3D organization and architecture, specifically in that window. So with that, I will go to the second part of my talk that now focuses on the interplay between 3D organization and transcription in the context of self-aid chains. So a few years back, we decided to address this question in the context of reprogramming of somatic cells, specifically mouse embryonic fibroblasts, into induced pluripotent stem cells. So this process, I think it's one of the most striking examples of how transcription factors can drive dramatic self-aid changes. So Yamanaka factors can really reverse a defined somatic fate all the way back to pluripotent state. And what we were wondering is that how transcription factors are able to induce or coordinate all of these multiple changes, transcriptional changes, and epigenetic changes, as well as what's happening at the level of 3D chromatin organization. Today, we'll just highlight some of our results, specifically in the 3D organization, using a process that's called HiChIP. So HiChIP is actually similar to what has been originally described also as ChiaPET or PLAC-seq, and that was established by the Howard Chang lab. And it allows to, it builds in the same 3C principle, but practically it's like combining an IC and a HiC with a chromatin immunoprecipitation. So you implement a chromatin immunoprecipitation step with an antibody of interest, so we can specifically pull down and enrich and characterize at high resolution chromatin conducts that are bound by a transcription factor of interest or enriched to histone mark of interest. So in our case, we applied that for H3K27 acetylation, which we know it's a hallmark of active enhancers and promoters. So by doing this H3K27 HiChIP and starting an endpoint of this process, we're able to identify tens of thousands of putative enhancer-promoter, enhancer-enhancer, promoter-promoter interactions, and actually see a very drastic rewiring, with many of these interactions being lost once pluripotency is established and others being de novo established. And these are just few examples here. Again, maybe I didn't highlight that before. I'm sure you are familiar, but for the ones that they are not familiar with this assays, just imagine always in the diagonal, the linear DNA, and every signal off diagonal, a frequent interaction between this part of the genome with this part of the genome. So here, for example, we see that JAK1 gene establishes multiple distinct conducts with intergenic enhancers, specifically in fibroblasts, but all of these conducts are lost in pluripotent stem cells, and vice versa for SOX2. And something that I also would like to highlight, if you would do HiC analysis in a similar depth or even a little higher depth than a HiChIP, we would see this general reorganization around these locus between MEFs and pluripotent stem cells, but we will lose these definitions and many of these very defined conducts. So that's the reason we continue with HiChIP, and then we integrated RNA-seq analysis, and we saw that a loss of a HiChIP interaction associated with transcriptional silencing, whereas transcriptional deregulation, whereas gain of interactions with upregulation, suggesting that at least the conducts we detect by HiChIP are indeed appear to be active regulatory conducts and may connect the right enhancer to the right gene. Now, in addition to the classic pairwise one-to-one interaction of one enhancer to one gene, we often find cases where enhancers appear to conduct in many more genes than other enhancers, forming a so-called hubs. So this type of highly interacting regions have been described in many different contexts, with many different assays ranging from regular HiSeq, ChiaPET, or CaptureSeq. Now, the reason we decided to focus on these hubs is that they have some very interesting features. Genes within these hubs have significantly higher expression levels than genes that are not looped or a single loop, and we see that the higher the degree of connectivity, the higher the expression. Also, genes within these hubs tend to be associated more closely to cell identity, in this particular case, so with stem cell identity, pluripotent stem cell identity. And finally, we find that gene pairs within this hub have much higher probability to be co-regulated compared to gene pairs that they are in linear proximity randomly, a similar linear proximity but randomly, or within TADs. So and this is just the one example of how this co-regulation would look for three hub-connected genes in the context of reprogramming. So all of them appear to coordinately be activated at late stages of reprogramming. So this practically would suggest that hubs may be important for the coordinated activation of important genes for cell identity. And indeed, we saw that when we perturb, at least for specific loci, either directly this highly interacting enhancer or factors that are particularly rich in these hubs, such as the KLF factors in our case, we cause partial dissociation, disassembly of these hubs and coordinated downregulation of two or more of hub-connected genes. So building on this and other data, we start coming up with the hypothesis that these highly interacting hubs may constitute actually important centers for regulating the transcriptional program of a certain cell identity. So if we identify such hubs and modulate these hubs, identify them with approaches such as HiChIP, and modulate either the hubs or the factors that bring them together, we may be able to disrupt more efficiently the core regulatory network of a cell or modulate even specific self-aid decisions. So currently we are testing this hypothesis in multiple different contexts beyond reprogramming, so including tumorigenesis, in vitro differentiation, but also early development. And I will present some of these our efforts, which is still a work in progress by an amazing team of scientists in my group, where they try to map these enhancer interactions and these hubs in the context of very early embryonic decisions. So we all know that development occurs with progressive and binary decisions early on. So the totipotent blastomers will give rise initially to trophoectoderm that would surround the embryo and inner cell mass. And subsequently, inner cell mass will give rise to primitive endoderm, which also contribute to extra embryonic tissues such as yolk sac, or epiblast, which will actually eventually differentiate to give rise to all embryonic tissues. So a lot is known about the signals and mass regulators that dictate each one of these fates, but much less is known about the enhancer and non-coding elements that are important. So obviously addressing these questions in the context of embryos is quite challenging, very limited material. So we decided, for at least for this genome-wide study, to use embryo-derived stem cell lines that recapitulate important molecular and functional features of each one of these fates. So we use trophoblast stem cells as proxy from trophoectoderm, embryonic stem cells as proxy from preimplantation epiblast, and then Zen cells, extraembryonic endoderm cells, as a proxy for primitive endoderm. And we applied multiple layers of characterization with two goals in mind. One, to build 3D enhancer connectomes that may characterize each one of these cell lines and appreciate the degree of remodeling between these cell fates, but also identifying novel and core enhancer elements that may dictate these fates. So we'll present some of our ongoing our results so far. Based on the ChIP-seq analysis, what we see is that more than 50% of the peaks that we detect for each cell fate, it seems to be exclusive or significantly enriched in each cell fate. So they appear to be largely cell type specific, and only a few of them are shared across two or all three cell lines. The same stands true for superenhancers. So if we call superenhancers simply with a Rose algorithm based on this signal, we find that only a small set of them are shared between the three fates, and the majority are cell type specific. Now, when we perform motif analysis for any of these cell type specific picks, we find, among others, the usual suspects, so master regulators of TSC fates, such as TFAP2A, NANO, COX4, and SOX2 for the embryonic stem cell state, and also GATA4, GATA6, and SOX17 for the same. So these just simply practically tells us that the picks that we detect are most likely indeed the most relevant for this fate and are largely governed by these master regulators of each identity. So then we were curious to see to what degree this very drastic epigenetic remodeling of the level of enhancers is also accompanied by large-scale chromatin reorganization. So for that, we initially performed compartment HiC and more specific compartment analysis, and we saw that about 5 to 20, less than 20% of the genome seems to undergo significant compartmental changes, with only a few hundreds of windows truly switching from B to A or A to B in each pairwise comparison. Something that we found very intriguing, and it stands true for any 3D genomics assay and analysis we did so far, is that we find that the two extra embryonic lineages that represent the PRE, the primitive endoderm, and the ectoderm, and they seem to be to acquire very similar 3D organization. So they have overall very limited differences compared to comparison with ESCs. So that we don't know what exactly means. That could either mean some type of convergence of the architecture to support their specialized function, or simply highlights the differences and the uniqueness of embryonic stem cells, which are pluripotent. They have a lot of tasks to do later in development. So when we try to integrate compartment analysis with RNA-seq or ChIP-seq, we find, as expected, that B2A switches, for example, associate with transcriptional upregulation, or A to B with transcriptional downregulation, and similar with K27 acetyl. And although only a very small fraction of signature genes appear to be part of these compartmental cell changes, so compartments cannot explain the full picture, we find important regulators such as SOX2 or SOX17 being part of these compartmental shifts. For example, SOX2 is in a very strong A compartment in ESCs, but it switches in a B compartment, both ESCs and Zen. Whereas SOX17, which is a hallmark of Zen identity, is in a strong compartment in A in Zen, but becomes a big compartment in ESCs. So this is one of that highlights the similarity that I mentioned, that SOX17, for example, that's also not expressed and fully and not even active in as a locus in TSCs, again appears to be within an A compartment. So since compartment cannot explain the full epigenetic remodeling and the signature genes of it, the differential expression of each genes, we decided to check on TAD subtype level. And what we saw is that we have a rather limited changes on the level of a boundary insulation, but a much more widespread changes on the level of interactivity when we check on stripes of 500 kb upstream and downstream of its region. So that documents that there must be a large degree of 3D chromatin reorganization in each one of these fates that we then seek to determine the much higher resolution using, again, H3, K27, HiChIP, with a focus always on enhancer promoter interactions. So by applying this assay now in each one of these types, we find again tens of thousands of putative enhancer promoter, promoter interactions mostly. And only less than 30% appear to be relatively conserved in the three cell types, but in the majority we see this very large reorganization, rewiring that is consistent with epigenetic remodeling of enhancers that we see. So when we try to understand what this, how this conducts look like and what they may mean for transcription, we find two categories. So we find this type of very highly interacting and interconnected conducts, but also we find many large scale or more short scale interactions that they often skip multiple independent genes, multiple intermediate genes and enhancers. So to see if that means anything, that any of these contexts mean anything for gene expression, we did a very simple classification of genes as interacting, so when their promoter is part of a high chip loop or more than one, and skipped, so they are in between these loops, and then completely outside these loops or halves. And what we saw is that genes that are part of these high chip interactions have significantly higher expression compared to skipped or outside genes, even when we focus on genes that in all of these genes contain its HK27 acetylation in the promoter. So we find these findings intriguing for two reasons. One, because again, it reminds us that there must be some degree of specificity of how an enhancer decides whether to skip or interact with a gene. But also that interacting genes, it seems that they may receive additional regulatory input of these interactions from these distal, let's say, enhancers, which may enhance their transcriptional activity. So these are things now we try to follow up with some modeling. Something that is also consistent with what I saw in the context of reprogramming, and it appears to be true for every cell type we have checked so far, is that we always have this positive correlation between connectivity and expression levels. And we try to understand how an increased connectivity may affect gene regulation. We can imagine two different scenarios. One is that we have one promoter interacting with multiple enhancers. In this case, all of these enhancers confer phenotypic robustness on these cells, as it has been described in the context of development with functional screens. So there is some enhancer redundancy or enhancer synergies. On the other hand, we may have one enhancer conducting two or more genes, and in this case, there may be gene co-regulation or gene commutation. Obviously, in reality, things are much more complicated. You find both scenarios coexisting at different ratios and numbers. So if we focus on a more promoter-centric analysis, we usually find that the most connected genes tend to be genes linked to cell identity, and if we do the opposite, that also stands true. So gene signatures, so genes that are exclusively expressed in each one of these cell lines, tend to have a significantly higher connectivity in the respective cell type, with a minimum of 3 to 5, median to 3 to 5 connections per gene. And these contain all of our favorite regulators for its fate, NANOG, that has been very well characterized by multiple 3C approaches in the past. So you see NANOG interacting with multiple of these distinct upstream and downstream enhancers, but also SOC17, which is less characterized. It seems to establish multiple contacts with all of these mostly downstream enhancers. Now, if any of these connections mean anything for this gene, to what degree these enhancers can be redundant, or if there is any type of hierarchy with a dominant or less dominant enhancer, are questions that we try to follow up now by actively perturbing systematically these enhancers for select loci, and hopefully in the future also genome-wide. Now we will go to the enhancer-centric analysis. We see that in hubs where we have two or more genes connected, the degree of co-regulation compared to anti-correlation in any pairwise comparison is significantly enriched within hubs. And we can use a number of other negative controls. I saw you only two of them here. So it seems this enrichment of co-regulation is much higher than gene pairs, again, within tags, or gene pairs of just the most proximal gene. So that's again highlights the potential using hubs as a proxy for co-regulated genes. So to summarize this part of my talk, what we saw is that we have drastic enhancer remodeling and some degree of 3D reorganization around the very first embryonic self-fate decisions. Enhancer promoter and promoter interactions seem to occur, as has been described, in many different contexts, again, in very complex ways, of often skipping genes, suggesting the presence of mechanisms of some kind of specificity between enhancer and promoter communication. And the higher connectivity correlates with higher transcriptional levels, supporting potential additive regulatory impact of all of these distal enhancers. And that genes within hubs show significantly higher probability of co-regulation during lineage transitions. So now ongoing and future directions, as I've already briefly mentioned, is first focusing a little bit on computational analysis and try to better build these networks and predict the central nodes, and also decide which of these features may of the high chip features, for example, may be better predictive for the either levels of expression or the cell type specificity of expression. We also obviously go for functional derogation of all candidate putative enhancers. So with these two together, we hopefully will come up with more robust criteria of what may make an enhancer important for gene locus or even for the whole transcriptional network. And finally, we are also interested in dissecting what may which are the organizational principles around these very highly interacting enhancers and the possibility that they are really formed and form a subnuclear compartments with specific proton-proton interactions. So we want to profile this hub microenvironment. So with that, I think it's the two main parts of the talk, but I would like to use just a few less minutes to introduce a very recent study which exemplifies the way we try to dissect regulatory logic of a locus. In this particular study, a collaboration with Matthias Stadtfeld and led by two very driven postdocs in my group, Boaz and Lorianne, who decided to study what determines the epigenetic stability of a very important imprinting cluster that's called DLK-DIO3 cluster. Again, I guess needless to say in this audience that imprinting is one of the most striking epigenetic phenomena where you get a monoallelic expression of genes in allele-specific and parent of origin-specific manner. So in this case, you get, for example, DLK1 and all of the other blue-labeled genes are exclusively expressed from the paternal allele, whereas you get GTL2 and other non-coding RNAs exclusively from the maternal allele. And previous studies have shown that the regulation of this entire locus that spans about one megabase seems to rely on a very critical differential methylated region that's called IGDMR. And deletion of this region results to destabilization or is called loss of imprinting. So you get a bi-maternal phenotype, which is detrimental for normal development, but also is frequently observed in other cases such as cancer. So we are interested to see how this IGDMR acts to preserve and maintain stability of this locus. And when we took a closer look on this locus just simply by unsampling published an in-house data set, and here are only a tiny fraction of them, we start getting an idea that there may be two elements with distinct molecular properties within this IGDMR. So it seems that they have this upstream region, which is mostly represented repressor-like. So it has a CpG island with very strong binding of this repressive ZFP57 protein, whereas the second half that we call TRE is more enhancer-like, and it has actually an active bidirectional transcription too, and K27 acetylation. So to address how each one of these elements contribute to imprinting maintenance, we took advantage of a very powerful allele-specific reporter that was generated in Matthias Stadtfeld group, and where they introduced the Venus or tomato reporter downstream for the DLK1 locus, the DLK1, which is normally expressed only from the paternal allele. So we extended also this model in the context of a hybrid background, which will give us the chance to utilize SNPs within either IGD or the IGDMR, so we can target do targeting in a little specific manner. And in parallel, obviously, we use the very rich tool set of Cas9 technologies, so from direct deletion to epigenetic engineering in an allele specific fashion. And to briefly summarize what we saw is that indeed IGDMR seemed to be a functionally bipartite element, with each one of these, the CGI or TRE, playing a distinct, even opposing, and allele specific functions. So specifically, when we delete the maternal TRE, and only the maternal TRE, the TRE from the maternal allele, we see that we get from the normal, which is only paternal DLK1 expression, we shift to a biallelic DLK, and that also coincides with a global hypermethylation of this locus, not only on the IGDMR, but also in the downstream GTL2 promoter. Whereas when we delete the paternal CGI, then we get exactly the opposite phenotype, where both TLK alleles are silenced and the entire locus becomes this time hypomethylated, so loses its methylation. And in parallel, you lose this allele specificity or allele specific chromatin conformation, which normally only in the maternal allele you have an interaction between IGDMR and GTL2. And upon this deletion, you get both alleles resembling the maternal phenotype. So then we did additional experiments to understand how each one of these elements actually act to preserve imprinting and why we have so dramatic phenotypic changes upon their perturbation and molecular changes. And just to summarize our result just with a model, what do we believe is happening is that, excuse me, the paternal CGI, it seems that is actively preventing demethylation of the paternal allele or of the entire allele, either by preventing the activity and binding of TET, but also de novo demethylation. So if when we delete this element, now we enable binding of TET, demethylation, and then maternalization of that allele. On the other hand, when we delete we believe that the TRE on the maternal allele acts to prevent de novo hypermethylation of this locus. So when we this element also acts as an enhancer, and that has been described in other studies, and also we confirm them. So in addition to act as a typical enhancer, transcriptional enhancer of GTL2, it also acts the extra task to prevent DNA methylation. So when we delete it, DNMT3A specifically seems to bind in the entire locus, hypermethylates both IGDMR and GTL2, and cause this maternal to paternal switch. So obviously there are a lot of open questions left with this study, with one of them being, okay, what is the role now of these distinct elements in the establishment of imprinting and not just the maintenance? To what degree this mechanism is cell type specific, because we did all of these studies in the context of pluripotent stem cells. And finally, the very intriguing non-canonical function of this TRE enhancer, which not only actively enhance the transcription of this downstream gene, but prevents DNA methylation, to what degree this is a common feature of other developmental enhancers. So with that, I would like to thank this incredible crowd of people, both from my group and the Matthias Stadtfeld group, that really makes our everyday very interesting and exciting. We are fortunate to have wonderful collaborators, include I mentioned work with Matthias and some with Hatzadonakis, who helped us a lot with this early lineage project. We also have multiple ongoing directions where we test the role of HAB in different contexts, including the context of diabetes, glioblastoma, lymphoma, etc. Aris Tsirikos group in NYU, together with many of his postdocs that play a very important role for guiding or performing some of the computational analysis. We have great funding at this point. We are very fortunate for that. The last thing I wanted to bring your attention, a great opportunity, my very first postdoc, Daphne Cambilite Giammartino, is a great scientist and really an incredible mentor. She's moving on to establish her own group in the Italian Institute of Technology in Genova, and she will be looking for students and postdocs soon, so please consider it. And with that, I'm very happy to take any questions.